in the last, I think, one, two problems. The other two problems, security evaluation one, capital budgeting two, another. And then there's a bunch of other questions on the back, which may be extra credit. These questions on the back, from page 10 to page 14, I will give you these questions. They're a little bit different than the ones that we've given in the term because of the assessment. Questions that the department wants me to give you so you can understand anything about finance. Okay. So they want me to basically give you these questions and then test you on these. So we'll try to get through those too. So any questions on what we're doing? So we've already laid a fairly solid foundation in macroeconomic analysis and capital structure, capital discount rates, interest rates, yield curves, all of those things. Okay. So what we're going to do now is we're going into the capital budget. Okay. It's called capital budget. And it's also called financial feasibility. And it's called investment analysis. And it's called investment underwriting. And the process can be used to evaluate stocks, to evaluate companies, to evaluate public companies, private companies, real estate assets, real estate developments, real estate acquisitions, mortgages, the applications are basically the same. It's just, what are you trying to evaluate? And who are you valuing for? That'd be it. And so you're going to walk into different shops. You're going into a venture capital firm, if you're going into an investment banking firm, if you're going into a private equity firm, if you're going into a publicly traded company, or a private company, the methodologies are all the same. So they're just nuanced, depending on what you're doing. Okay. All right. Any questions so far? No? Okay, let's go through the first one. As we know, there are four main valuation methodologies. In this case study, we are going to use EBITDA, earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation. Right off the bat, what kind of company are you trying to value? When you're using EBITDA. That's the type of company. What? Startup. No, you have like startups. You're not established, large company that have been around 100 years. These are small companies that may be around 3 to 5 years. Okay. The following the case study assumptions: perpetuity. We're going to use that for the initial value and the terminal value for the DC. Gordon growth model. We're going to use that for the initial value and we use it for the terminal value too. Multiple approach in this first case study. We have multiples of 22, 44. And 55 times earnings. So what we've done is we have experience in finding out transactions that have occurred, similar types of companies, and from our research, we were able to determine the multiples that were used on the cash flows to get to the valuations. Okay? And then we're going to use the discounted cash flow. So this is a small tech startup company in the software consumer products space being bought by a private equity or a venture capital firm. So we're the venture capital firm. We are going to buy this company. Or we could be the principals of the technology company, and we want to do the valuation to figure out how much we can sell the company for. Would that be important to know? How much is it going to cost us to buy the company? Or how much can we sell it? Which side would you rather be on? The one that where you have to do the valuation to figure out what you can sell it for, or what you can buy it for? What?
What you can sell it for.
Which you can sell it for, because you were one of the founders of the company, you incubated the company, you worked your butt off in the last 3 to 5 years to get to the point where you could sell it to a large company and cash out and make millions of dollars. Does that sound like fun? Would it be nice to have $3 to $5 million in pocket?
Yeah.
Net of taxes?
Yeah.
You could live in Tiburon, Sausalito, and have a house in Santa Cruz and a house in Tahoe. five motorcycles, three bikes, five cars. Does that sound like fun? Sounds like fun to me. Okay, so let's bottle this up. Okay. So we know that what's the free cash flow last year or this year? When we're doing the valuations, are we using last year's, this year's, or next year's cash flows?
Next
year's. So this is going to be the case study, the first one. This is going to be the tech case. So what's this year's cash flow? What's this year's cash flow? What's this year's cash flow? Read the case study. What's this year's cash flow? What is it? $20 million. And actually, I highly encourage you to participate. Or what I can do is go to the PowerPoint presentations and click them through for the next 3 hours. All right, so last year's cash flow was $20 million. Free cash flow growth rate. So we got a going-in growth rate of 15% and a terminal growth rate of 10%. We're going to probably use that for the Gordon growth. I would probably take notes. I know your generation doesn't take notes, but I would probably take notes. One of my students, a couple semesters ago, said he was in the back with his feet up on the desk, lounged back with his hands in the back like this, and I was writing on the board, just like sweating, and I turn around and he's just like totally laid back in the back there. And it's like, Paul, what are you doing back there? It's like, shouldn't you be taking notes? Because Professor Susan, our generation, doesn't take notes. And I said, oh, so you all were born with photographic memories where you can remember everything you see and everything you put on the board? I don't believe it. So you've got to be taking notes, and you've got to take really good notes. Okay. The expected rate of return is 30%. What would that also be called? What is that also called? What's the expected return also used for? What's it also called? What is it also called and used for? Sample. What's it also called? What is the expected return? What are we going to use it for? What are we using the 30% expected return for? What are we going to use it for? What? Yeah, but what is it? What do you use it for? What?
Define the risk.
Well, there's three rates embedded in it. Well, what do we use the 30% for? What's it called? What?
Calculate
the present value using the discounted cash. So it's the discount. Okay. And we also have a terminal discount rate that we're going to use using the valuation for the terminal. We also have pro forma cash flow. So the first year is 40%, second is 28%, third year is 25%, and the fourth year is 15%. What's the holding period? What's the holding period? What? 3 years. We'd like to buy these companies, incubate them, restructure them, reposition them, and sell them for a lot more money. The target company acquisition price is $200 million. Okay, we got it. So we know that the $20 million is this year's free cash flow. What's next year's? Oh, and I would probably break out your calculators, because you're going to need the calculators in the exam. Okay. And every time you walk into this finance class, you've got to break out your calculator for the next year. And if you don't have a calculator, you need to buy it. If you don't have a calculator, you probably need to borrow it. Because it says right there at the bottom, it says holding period. Okay, so what's next year's cash flows? How do I get next year's cash flows? What? How do I get next year's cash flows? I'm just gonna be really irritating. How do you get next year's cash flows? Yeah, with growth rate.
The 40%.
Got it. So what's 20 million times 1.4?
28 million.
What is it? and then CFO T plus two. How do we get the second year's cash flow?
You times that number by 28% or 2.2.
So what's 28 million times 1.28? Break out your calculators, do your calculation. Break out your phones, do your calculation. Break out your laptop, do the calculation. If you're not doing the calculation, you're just copying the answers, and that's not going to cut it. Okay? We're going to step it up a notch. You've been through a lot in the first grade class. Now we're going into application. Okay? You're going to need to do the calculations, and you need to verify the calculations. Because I'm not going to rely on one person to do the calculation. I need verification validation from multiple people in the classroom or in the meeting that we're having. This is an investment underwriting meeting. This is the kind of meetings that you're going to be involved in if you want to be in this area. Okay? It doesn't matter if you're in marketing or ops or entrepreneurship or digital media or whatever. In 20, 30 years from now, you're probably going to be nominated into an executive role and you're going to be doing this. So if you learn it now, it'll be a lot easier. So what's 28 million times 1.28?
35,840,000.
What is it?
35,840,000.
Okay, and then round up.
800.
Got it. Okay. And then cash flow in T plus two. How do we get the cash flow in 30?
Times by 25, 1.25.
Okay. So give me the number. Okay, what's the number?
44.8 million.
Got it? Okay. Do you think that in your career you'll be dealing with projects or dealing with companies that will be dealing with multi-million dollar projects? Time to go off and take on the responsibility as business majors. Your business majors are going to be highly accountable and responsible for your clients' well-being, their company's well-being, their employees. You have a moral responsibility. We're not sociology majors, but history or philosophy majors or business majors. We're different from leaders. Okay, so we already have the cash flows for the third year. What do we have to do to calculate the term loan? What do we have to do to calculate the term loan?
Do you
times by
the C plus four?
We're going to have to do the fourth year. When I calculate the term loan value, do I need to have to grow the cash flows out in 4 years? Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, so I need to grow it out in 4 years. What is it?
1.15? Yeah, which equals 51.5.
What is it?
51.5.
We're gonna use this to get the terminal value. Got it. Okay, so now we're doing pretty good. So first things first, let's do the perpetuity model. Okay, model number one. Under the perpetuity model, what do you assume the cash flows are going to do forever? Stay constant or grow at a constant rate? Are they going to grow at a constant rate? Anybody else? Are they going to remain flat forever or are they going to grow at a constant rate? Using perpetuity. Okay, I've got two growing at a constant rate.
Grow at
a constant rate. Three are growing at a constant rate. Now that's called group. When basically a bunch of people say the wrong answer and you say the wrong answer. No, you have to be really super careful. Because there's going to be people in your company that are going to sabotage you and make you look stupid in front of everybody. Because they want your job. Or they want to do it. I'm totally serious. Okay. So you have to say the right answer. Okay. So under the perpetuity model, do you assume that the cash flows remain flat forever or grow at a constant rate? Flat. Under the Gordon growth, you're going to be in an interview where you're going to ask these questions, and you can go on and you're out. You're done. So, the board broke to assume that the cash flows are going to be flat and growing costs. Growing costs, great. So under the perpetuity, it's really noisy on this side and there's nothing going on up here. So under the perpetuity model, do you assume that the cash flows are going to remain flat or grow at a constant rate forever?
Growing at a constant rate.
Hold on, let this sign. Under the perpetuity model, do you assume that the cash flows are going to remain flat or grow at a constant rate forever? Okay, we already said that the constant growth rate was wrong. Perpetuity model assumes that the cash flows are going to remain flat. I'm not picking on you, I'm just like, this is it. We're already 6 weeks into the semester. We've gone over this like four or five times. So, under the perpetuity model, you assume that the cash flows are going to remain flat forever. Under the Gordon growth model, they're going to grow at a constant rate. You may want to write that down. Okay. All right, so under the perpetuity model, what's the cash flow that we're going to use to come up with a valuation? Using the first intrinsic valuation method, what cash flow are we going to use to come up with the valuation using the perpetuity model? What cash flow do we use first? Okay, I'm going to use the fifth year, but we don't have the fifth year. Okay, what year's cash flow do we use to calculate the intrinsic value using the perpetuity model?
Next year's.
And what's the next year's cash flow? We're going to use to apply to be able to get the valuation to come up with the first intrinsic valuation.
30%.
What is it?
30%.
Okay, got it. Now I'm going to turn around and I want to see everybody do the calculations on their calculators or on your phone. On your phone or on your calculator? On your phone or on your calculator? On your phone or on your calculator? Do you have calculators?
What do you want us to round it to?
Yeah. Round it to one decimal. What is it? 93.4. Right?
Yes.
Yeah. That's our first valuation. You did it. You got you stoked. Okay? Now we're going to do the Gordon growth model. What cash flow do we use to get the intrinsic valuation using the Gordon growth model?
Next year's
cash flow. And what's next year's cash flow?
$28 million.
Got it. And what's the discount rate we're going to use? 30%. I only hear one person. And then what growth rate are we going to assume that the cash flows are going to grow at forever? What growth rate are we going to use to assume that the cash flow is going to grow at a constant rate? What is it?
10%.
Do I have 10%?
That's the terminal.
Okay, that's the terminal. That's what we're going to use for the discounted cash flow.
It's 15%.
Okay. So what is minus 0.15? So what's 0.3 minus 0.15?
0.15.
What's 28 million divided by
0.15?
What's I want to see the calculators. Calculators. On your phone. On your spreadsheet. On your phone. You need to do the calculations. Do not just sit there and copy the answer. I will change the questions. Okay, if you want me to. You don't do the work now, I have to make for you a little exam. What is it?
186.7.
Great. Perfect. Done. Now we have the word growth model. Perfect. Okay, what's the next methodology we're going to use? You're going to use the multiple. And then what cash flow do we use to calculate the intrinsic value using the multiple approach? next year's, and what's next year's cash flow? 28 billion. Got it. So the first thing what I would do is start calculating multiples. Okay. Can I calculate a multiple by taking 1 divided by, what did we use for the perpetuity, 0.3? Can I get a multiple by dividing 1 divided by the discount rate? Yes or no? Yes. Yes. Yes, I can. So what's 1 divided by 0.3?
3.23.
What is it? 3.23 is not, probably not. What is it? 1 divided by 0.5. What's the multiple that I get?
6.67.
Okay. Let's just use 7. Okay. 7 times. Does that sound right?
That's better.
What's 28 million times 3?
84 million.
And what was the perpetuity model?
93.
This is not coming out. Because the perpetuity model should be exactly the same as the one.
So then you do it by the Gordon Road, it's 196.
Yeah, but I want to test it first using the 1 divided by 0.3 should be the exact same thing as 828 divided by 0.3. Should be the exact same thing. So either the multiple. So the multiple may be wrong. So what's divided by 1 divided by 0.3?
Wait, no, that's actually 93.3 million. The 84 is wrong.
Thank you. There we go. Now that was awesome because we were in a meeting and I was up here doing it. I can't do the math in my head. If you let me go down the road and do this stuff on the board in front of the investment committee and it's wrong, I'm going to get fired. And you'll probably get fired too because you work for me. Don't make mistakes. Always check your numbers at least 2 feet. Okay. You've got to check the numbers. You need to validate and verify the numbers. You need to correct me when it's wrong. Do not let me go through all of these exercises and give these people wrong answers. Okay? It's detrimental for us. Okay, and then what's 28 million times 7?
196 million.
Now it should be 186 million.
Okay, so
what is it?
6.67.
Got it. So it's 186. It should be 186.
Yeah, 186.
Got it. Here's what I'm trying to get at here. This is a learning exercise. The perpetuity model and the Gordon growth model are exactly the same as the multiple model. When you do 1 divided by the discount rate and 1 divided by I minus G, it's going to give you the exact same thing. The problem here is we have a tech company, all right? And the multiples using the perpetuity model and the multiples using the Gordon growth model are wrong. They're too low. So in corporate finance, the CFO, the head of the capital markets group, basically said when you call the investment bankers and call your friends over at other private equity firms who's looking to buy a company, and see what kinds of transactions they have done over the last year or two, similar to the acquisition of a company. In confidentiality, okay? if they will give you the information. Call Goldman Sachs. Hey, Goldman Sachs, have you done any kind of deals like this, you know, in the last 2 years? Yes, we have. And the multiples that we found out that the transactions went down in were basically 22, 44, and 55 times earnings, free cash. So this multiple. Okay. So we're going to use market multiples. And we're going to use, we're going to use a 55 times. We're going to use 44 times free cash flow, and we're going to use 22. So we're going to get a range of valuations using the multiple approach. So what's 55 times 28 million? Right, your calculators, do your calculations or do the mathematics in your head. What is it?
1,540
million. So basically 1.5
billion. That's a billion. That's a billion, yeah.
Cisco and Oracle, Salesforce, and those companies buy other companies for billions of dollars? Yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, they do. Do startup companies sell themselves for billions of dollars?
Yes.
Yes, they do.
So your numbers, 55, 44, and 22, are those just like the standard numbers we're supposed to use?
These are market determined multiples. These are actual transactions that have occurred over the last 2 years. By other companies that have bought tech companies, other companies that have sold themselves in the marketplace, and other investment banking operations that have advised on the sale and the acquisition of these types of companies. Okay. So these are market determined. These are theoretically determined. These are application market determined multiples.
So these are not standard for tech companies?
These are standard for tech companies.
Okay, only for tech companies.
Yeah, for this type of tech company.
Okay.
They're not just particularly the tech companies.
It's going to be tech companies, but this type of tech company. Okay, so you're going to call the investment banker, you're going to call your friends, you're going to call the CFO, and you're going to say, hey, we are looking to acquire or sell a small tech startup in the software consumer product space, and we are the private equity firm via one of the multiples that have gone down on deals, similar deals, over the last 2 years. And we'll give you, we'll talk to a bunch of people. They have done some of these deals. We came up with a range of 22, 44. We know the range of valuations. Okay. So what is 44 times 28 million?
1, 2, 3, 2.
Is it?
1, 2, 3, 2 million.
Got it? And what's 22 times the 28 million free cash? What is it?
661.
Is it that low?
Yeah, 616.
Okay, so it's what? 0.66, is that what you said?
616.
616. 616. Yeah, that's now we have to write. We usually start with one in the middle. Usually take one in the middle. As a starting point. And then as you do the research, you may say, oh, it's actually towards 55 times. Maybe it's more times 33 times, whatever, but it's kind of starting to get a range, a sensitivity analysis that you're conducting to get a range of values. Yes, sir.
So those are values and gravity?
Yes.
And then why are there so much different than these right there?
Because this is a very simplistic model that assumes that the cash flows are going to remain flat forever. And this assumes that the cash flows are going to grow at a constant rate forever. This assumes, as we already know, that we're buying the company here. But the company is going to be up here. So the multiple is going to be higher. So So we're gonna try to buy it maybe on 44 times, and then we sell the company at 55 times, and it's too late. We can't buy it at 22 times because we weren't willing to take the risk. We wanted to make sure that there was a growth path, that we knew that the sales revenue was scaling at an accelerated rate, and boom, did the transaction really quickly so you could get the company.
Would you always use a multiple approach for this type of
company? Yes. Because from what I've heard from the industry, from people who went to go work, people like yourself, who were doing internships in these private equity firms, which I highly recommend you do. These are some of the smartest people I've ever met. What they said is that perpetuity model and the Gordon growth model and the discounted cash flow model do not work. It's a multiple approach. We're going through it to show you that it doesn't work and to show you what industry actually uses and the valuation uses. So did that answer your question? Okay, so now we got the multiple. Now we need to do the DCF, discounted cash flow. You may want to zoom in on me over here if you can. If possible.
Yeah.
And if I do this here, will it show up pretty well?
Kind of. It looks like a little blurry on the screen.
Maybe I should do it over here.
Okay.
So you can zoom in over here. Because I have basically the cash flows here. So let's just use it. Let's do DCF over here. We're making this valuation first very simple because the EBITDA that we came up with, I'm just giving you the EBITDA numbers. But usually you would have a pro forma income statement for 2017, 2018, 2019, 2020, and 2021 for all of the line items to get your cash. Intrinsic value target company using the multiple approach. This is the intrinsic value using perpetuity. This is intrinsic value using word and growth. So what we're going to do later on, once we get the intrinsic valuations, using the different methodologies, we're then going to go back and weight them based on what models are used the most in the industry. But these are the intrinsic values using perpetuity, using growth, multiple approach. This is using comparable deals that have gone down. This is using theory, which is basically perpetuity. They're going to use that, and they're probably going to use the discounted cash. And you're going to model out a very extensive pro forma income statement. I'm doing tons of research. I'm then going to give you these top line cash flow numbers. I don't have time to teach you financial statement analysis for tech companies in this class. If you want to do that, then you need to take new venture capital finance, you need to take a financial statement analysis class, or you need to go work in an internship in one of these companies. Okay. All right, so we got it done. We got the cash flows. Excellent. So we already got the cash flows done. And what's the discount rate that we're going to use, the discount cash flows to get the present value? Do we want to get the present value? Okay, so what's the discount rate that we're going to use to discount the cash flows back to the present so we can figure out what the present value is using the discounted cash flow model? So what's the discount rate that we're going to use?
30%.
What is it? 30?
Yes.
Okay. So 1.3 to the 1, 1.3 to the 2, 1.3, what's the holding period?
3 years.
3 years. What is 1.3 to the 1 power? 1.3. What's 1.3 squared? Again, learn how to do this on your calculator because you got to be able to know how to do exponentials.
1.69.
What is it?
1.69.
Thank you. And what's 1.3 cubed?
2.20.
Got it. All right. Excellent. So let's get down to some numbers. So what's 28 million divided by 1.3? Can't hear you. What is it?
21.54.
I need to hear more people over here on this side because I'm only hearing two people, and there's 22 people in the room. I need you to do the calculations and verify that these are correct. Are these correct? Because if you say they're correct and they're wrong, and we make the wrong decision, I'm going to be fired, and you're going to be fired. And it'll be really fun because we'll go hang out in the hate. And buy some Grateful Dead stickers and go hang out at the end of the park. Okay. What's 35.8 million divided by 1.69?
16.1.
What is it?
21.18.
What is it?
21.18.
Now, is that correct?
Yeah.
Yep, okay, thank you. And what's 44.8 million divided by 2.2?
20.36.
What is it?
21.36.
Thank you. Okay. Excellent. So now do I just add those up to get the present value, and that's my value of the company? Is that what I do? So I just add those up, and that's the value of the company. Is that right?
You have to add the terminal value.
I got to get the terminal value. So we already grew up cash flow, right? So we already got the cash flow for year four. Now what do we do? What's our assumption? Do we assume that the cash, do you think that these cash flows for this company are going to remain flat forever, or do you think they're going to grow? They're going to grow. So what model are we going to use?
Gordon
Grow. Excellent. Nice job. And what's the terminal discount rate that we're going to use?
40%.
We're going to use 40%, not 30%. Okay. Why would we use 40%? What would be a reason why we would use a higher discount rate?
Because it's higher, it's more than 2.
What?
Because it's further into the future.
Yes, and can you predict the future with 100% certainty?
No.
Do you think that in a highly competitive tech environment that maybe a competitor that comes out and disrupts your cash flow growth rates? Totally. Okay. So you got to give it a higher discount. Okay. And then what's our growth rate that we're going to use? What growth rate are we going to use? What terminal growth rate are we going to use?
10%.
10%. Now, is that higher or lower than the going in?
Lower.
So why would we use a lower growth rate on the terminal growth rate than the going in growth rate? Why would we use a slower, lower growth rate compared to the going in growth rate?
Because by that time in the future, you're not going to have as much of a growth potential.
That's right. Do small companies grow or do large companies grow faster? Who grows faster?
Small
companies. So in 4 years from now, are you going to be a smaller company?
No.
Probably not. Probably not. So you look at this. So what's 51 million? What's 51.5 million divided by 0.3? What is it?
171.
171.
171.
171.
0.67.
Got it. Now, what do we do with the terminal value?
Add it.
Add it to?
Your present.
Then we add it to what? What do we add it to? Well, what do we do with the terminal value? Because the terminal value is an evaluation. Is it discounted? Well, no, it's hanging out there in year four, right? We're trying to get a present value. Don't we have to do something to the terminal value to get it to the present? We have to do what? Well, what do we do? You can't subtract it. It's just the cash flow out in year four. What do we do with it? We just take that cash flow and add it to the present value? Should we do something to cash flow? It's in year four. It's way out in year four. What do you do with cash flows in the future when you're calculating discounted cash flows? You get the present value, okay? So what are we going to do with the terminal value? Add it to what?
Present value.
No. And add it to the last year's cash flow. You need to write this down because this is where everybody makes a mistake. Everybody makes a mistake because they don't grow the cash flow out. They don't know to grow the cash flow out to year four. Calculate the terminal value and add the terminal value to the last year of the holding period. Add terminal value to last year. What's the total?
216.47.
So this is the total cash flow you are going to receive in the last year of the holding period. Now what do we do with that?
Then you add that to the present value.
What do we do?
Add it to the present value.
No, actually what we do is we discount it. We discount it. So you take the 216.47 divided by 2.2. So it's 216.47 divided by 2.2.
98.3.
What is it?
98.4.
Got it. Is that correct? Is that right?
Wait, how did you get that?
Is that correct?
Yes.
Is that right? It needs a validation verification. Is that correct?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, does everybody understand what I just did?
Could you go rewind?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is the hardest part.
I don't know how you got it.
That's okay.
Yeah.
That's okay. So we grew out the cash flows. Okay. I grew it out one more year. We use the terminal discount rate minus the terminal growth rate to get the 0.3. I took the 51.5 and went by 0.3, I got 171.67 million. That's my terminal value. I take the terminal value and I add it to the last year's cash flow. I get a total of 216.47. Why do we got to get that? Because this is about, after year four, right? How long is perpetuity? Because this thing's going to generate cash, right? Forever?
Yeah.
Right? How far can I go out in my Excel spreadsheet with the discount factors? Can I go to infinity in my Excel spreadsheet? Can I? Would I want it? Because basically the theory is, has anybody ever heard of isotope? Anybody take calculus?
I don't remember what it is. It sounds very familiar.
Yeah, the isotope, it's an isotope. It basically says that the present value of the cash flows are going to degrade over time, and eventually the discount rate is going to get so large that it's going to be infinitesimal. So instead of having a 30-year spreadsheet, what we can do is we can truncate it, figure out what the value of this is, and use the perpetuity or the Gordon growth model to figure out what this valuation is going to be. And then these are the cash flows, the discounted cash flows. So as the discount rate, as you go further out into the future, the discount rate's been so large that the present value is turning into basically zero. So instead of doing that, what you can do is you can capture year four through infinity by basically using the fourth year's cash flow and then use the perpetuity of the Gordon growth model to get the terminal value of all of these future cash flows in year three.
Because all the future cash flows are so low, you can use the terminal value?
Yeah, at some point in time, the discount rates are going to get so large that the present value of the cash flows are basically going to be zero. So to shorten the methodology, because we're only doing a three-year holding period, what we want to know is that these cash flows are worth on a discounted basis. What we can do is we can take the fourth-year cash flow, divide it by the discount rate to get the terminal value, or we can use Gordon growth to get the terminal value and add that terminal value to the third year. So what you're doing is you're capturing all of this in the terminal value. Because I don't want to do a 100-year spreadsheet. I want to do three-year holding period. So the value of the cash flows from year four on is captured in the terminal value. And the equation simplifies to the perpetuity model for the Gordon growth. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Make sense? So that's when we figure out the terminal value using the fourth year cash flow. And then we get the terminal value using the perpetuity of Gordon growth, take that terminal value and put it into the third year and discount it back under the holding period. So what is 216.47 divided by 2.2? It's 98.4. What's 98.4 plus 21.18 plus 21.54? Sum these up and this is the present value.
1141.12.
Got it. So now we got the present value using the DCF. Okay, got it. Using perpetuity Gordon growth multiple approach, which is the intrinsic value of the target company? DCF, which is PV, MPV, IRR, break even. Could you accept or reject this project? Okay, let's go through it. So we got one intrinsic value here, 141.12. We got perpetuity here at 93.4. We got Gordon growth at 186.7. And then we're going to use that 1.232. We'll just use that as a multiple approach. Okay. Got it. How much are we, what's the acquisition price?
200 million.
What's it?
200
million. 200 million?
Yes.
So here, we're going to buy this thing for 200 million. Well, what's 141.12 minus 200 million?
58.88.
Positive or negative?
Negative.
Negative what?
-58.88.
Got it. So my net present value is -58.88. But I accept or reject the project?
Reject.
Reject it. What about under the perpetuity? By MPV?
106.6.
Would I accept or reject? And what about over here? What's my net present value? Negative what? accept or reject it? Okay, well, what did we come up with over here? What's the MPV? Over here. What's the net present value? It's 1,232,000,000 minus 200,000,000.
1.032,000,000.
Is your net present value positive or negative?
Positive.
Did you accept or reject it? So reject, 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 accept. So when buying tech companies, what model would you use?
Multiple
approach. You use the multiple. So let's go through it over here. So you might need to maybe move the camera over or something. Finish it on this side.
Like move it over there.
Yeah, just as much as if you can go maybe this way.
Okay.
Maybe even that way. It doesn't matter. Just try to get as close as possible. All right. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go and do the number 7, page 7.
Yeah, I'm zoomed in.
Okay, so right here?
Yeah.
Okay. And you're going to need to take notes on this. All right. So that's basically the first pass. Now what we have to do is we have to build the investment decision-making matrix. Okay. Can you see this far, or do I have to go further?
A little further.
All right. see this? Can you see that? How's that coming out on the camera?
It looks like a little blurry, but it's...
Is that as far as the...
The zoom, yeah.
Is that as far as the extension cord goes?
No, I can move it more.
Why don't you pull it and then put it up there?
Okay.
Put the camera up there and you'll get a straight shot. Thank you for being the cinematographer. Are the videos helping?
Yeah.
Does anybody else videotape classes?
No.
You should definitely tell TJ.
You should request one of the rooms that have Galaxy. There's so many...
Kind of do this?
Yeah.
Can it follow you around or something?
Yeah, like videotapes the whole...
Oh, that's cool.
It's accessible.
So...
It's 360 camera, so it doesn't really need...